Hello, my name is Dr. Vineet Chopra, and I'm here today to talk to you about abdominal pain. This is coming from the Saint-Chopra Guide to Inpatient Medicine that I wrote with my colleague and research mentor, Dr. Sanjay Saint. This is the fourth edition, and this video is a brief overview of one of the chapters in the book. We hope you like it. Abdominal pain is challenging because there are so many potential diagnoses that can relate to pain in the belly. It's also challenging because the signs and symptoms are often non-specific. They can vary from mild to severe symptoms, and the signs can be either present or absent. The key challenge with abdominal pain is that life-threatening conditions can hide in the abdomen, and the consequences of wrongly attributing the pain to something benign can be catastrophic. So what we tell learners and what's important for you to know is that we always want you to respect the belly. If there's anything a good diagnostician will be humbled by, it's abdominal pain. So really think about this in a systematic and in a very thoughtful way. How do you approach abdominal pain? Well, we want you to think about a three-step approach, beginning first with systemic signs and symptoms. So when you think about a person with abdominal pain, you should ask, are there other systemic causes that may be driving this pain? For example, if the patient has strangely colored urine and has abdominal pain, maybe they have porphyria. If they hail from the Mediterranean area and their family has this history of recurrent abdominal pain crises, could they have familial Mediterranean fever and do they need further testing for that? Also, remember to look for endocrine changes, either in the skin or changes in their blood sugar, because Addison's disease and diabetic ketoacidosis can often present also with abdominal pain. And think about uremia in patients with kidney disease as a cause of nausea, vomiting, and abdominal pain, especially if their kidney function has deteriorated. The point here is never think about abdominal pain in isolation. Always think about it in the context of how is the patient presenting and what are their comorbidities. The other thing to always remember is referred pain. So pain in the abdomen can come from different sites in the body, and the most common sites are the thorax and the pelvis. We want you to think about pneumonia as a common cause, especially of upper quadrant pain. And that's because basilar pneumonias, those involving the bases of the lungs, can often cause pleural inflammation, which can rub against either the liver capsule or the splenic capsule to refer to right or left upper quadrant pain. In fact, I've seen this several times. So a febrile patient with cough and sputum production who presents with right upper quadrant pain should make you think a little bit about potential pulmonary causes of referred pain. I also want to highlight myocardial infarction as one of those causes of abdominal pain that you should probably never forget. So in an elderly patient or in a diabetic who's presenting with abdominal pain without a clear cause, always think about the heart. And remember in women to not forget the pelvic inflammatory diseases and ovarian torsion, all of which can also cause abdominal pain. The most helpful approach, however, is to consider the abdominal organs based upon anatomy and always think about infection, obstruction or ischemia as you work through the location of the organs and why they may be having the pain. So let's walk through this given the following grid. The first thing to think about is the location of the pain. So if somebody presents with right upper quadrant pain, we want you to think about the liver and the gallbladder as the two organs in that area. So inflammation or infection of those two organs can cause pain. So think hepatitis, hepatic tumor or abscesses, cholecystitis, and even stone disease like choledocholithiasis can end up causing cholangitis or other causes of abdominal pain in the right upper quadrant. Someone's got HIV, don't forget AIDS cholangiopathy as a cause of abdominal pain as well. If the pain is epigastric, remember that's the stomach, the pancreas, the duodenum, and the abdominal aorta. So ask yourself, is this patient potentially suffering from gastritis? Could they have peptic ulcer disease? Is the pain really sharp and stabbing? Does it go to the back? Could they have an abdominal aortic aneurysm? Do they have a history of alcohol intake? Could this be pancreatitis or stone disease? And again, remember cardiac disease as a potential cause of epigastric pain as well. Pain in the left upper quadrant is almost always the spleen. So look for splenic enlargement, hook under the rib cage if you can't feel it. Think about a splenic infarct in somebody who may otherwise be bacteremic or be at risk for splenic infarction, and think about abscesses as well. In an older patient who has known splenomegaly who becomes suddenly hypotensive, never forget splenic rupture. It is a life-threatening condition and is something should always be on your mind, especially in the setting of known spleen enlargement. Left to right lower quadrant pain can refer to a number of organs, specifically the appendix and the intestines. In women, you should think about the ovary and the fallopian tubes, and in men, the testes. Also remember the genitourinary system, including the kidney and the ureter. So diseases such as appendicitis, diverticulitis, ovarian cysts, or torsion. In younger women, think about ectopic pregnancy or pelvic inflammatory disease if they're sexually active. And in men, don't forget to look for epididymitis and testicular torsion as causes of abdominal pain. If somebody has a history of stone disease or is at risk of stone formation, think about nephrolithiasis. And don't forget to look at flank pain in the patient who may have pyelonephritis. Periumbilical pain is one of those interesting ones because it can refer to the small intestine, the appendix, especially when appendicitis begins, before it localizes to the parietal peritoneum and the visceral peritoneum in the right lower quadrant, and the abdominal aorta. So when you see periumbilical pain, think about bowel obstruction, think about appendicitis, and don't forget ischemic bowel disease. And hypogastric pain, or pain in the hypogastric area, could refer to the bladder. In women, the uterus and the ovaries and the fallopian tubes are also at play. Think about cystitis, urethritis, nephrolithiasis, PID, and endometriosis, especially if it's pain in that area. So I like this location-based approach, mapping to the underlying organs. And again, this is a very systematic way of thinking about the causes and the potential organs involved with abdominal pain. You also want to try to elicit certain symptoms that may help you increase the likelihood of certain conditions and organ involvement. So somebody has suprapubic pain or hypogastric pain with dysuria and frequency, maybe they've got a kidney or a bladder infection. If somebody presents with nausea, vomiting, and diarrhea, is it possible that they have some type of gastritis, or maybe they've got pancreatitis? The diarrhea from pancreatitis may just be chronic pancreatitis and malabsorption. Jaundice and itching in a patient with abdominal pain should make you think about liver disease. And if it's a younger patient, think about stone disease from the gallbladder that may be causing obstructive cholangiopathy. Pain that gets better when someone stands up is almost always pancreatic pain, so think about the pancreas. And an abrupt onset of pain in the midline that is completely out of proportion to the exam should make you think about ischemia, specifically the mesenteric blood vessels. So look for risk factors around cardiac dysrhythmias or embolic disease that may be causing that as well. And think about a serum lactate as a diagnostic test. Remember, pain exacerbated by the flexion of the abdominal muscles refers to pain from the abdominal wall. That could be all related to some type of abdominal trauma, or there may be an intra-abdominal cause of that in the wall itself. Make sure to look for that when you're thinking about flexion of the abdominal musculature. So what's our approach to the patient? We always begin with a good history. This is key in abdominal pain. Ask for when the pain began, what exacerbated it, what they were doing at the time, what makes it better, what's the site, what's the radiation, what's the severity, and ask if they've had this before or if other family members have had it. Do a good physical exam, especially if somebody has severe abdominal pain. This is difficult to do, so don't forget to flex the knees, relax the abdominal muscles, and do a good auscultation to look for bowel sounds, but also for tenderness and rebound and guarding. Get your usual labs, your CBC, your basic, and lactate if you're thinking about ischemia. Don't forget an ECG and a chest x-ray, especially if you're thinking about referred pain. I want to put in a word here for abdominal CT scan because a lot of learners are reluctant and sometimes hesitate to pull the trigger on a CT. Remember that an abdominal CT is better than an ultrasound for evaluating most intra-abdominal structures. And what I commonly see is too much hesitation in ordering the CAT scan and potentially missing diagnoses. And I would say if the bowel is a primary concern and you're worried about contrast, sometimes you can avoid the contrast, especially if the creatinine is elevated. But remember, the ideal study is an oral and IV contrast study because it allows you to look at the bowel walls, intra-abdominal pathologies, and also abscesses, which you will miss if you don't use contrast. In a patient who has unexplained belly pain, and especially if they're elderly, move to the CAT scan early and quickly. It will save you a lot of pain and trouble in managing that patient. So that's it. Thank you. I hope you liked this brief overview of abdominal pain. If you like this talk and want to read more, please consider purchasing the Saint-Chopra Guide to Inpatient Medicine. You can use the promo code here to save 30%. And I hope you have a wonderful day. Thanks very much for your attention.